The man who knows how to keep himself in the honor of God is keeping himself. The wicked one can't touch him. The main way the wicked one can touch you is through your gall of bitterness, through your bond of iniquity, through your roots of rejection, through your wounds that get you craving comfort, craving acceptance, craving some kind of honor to assuage the feelings of your pain. And it leaves you vulnerable. If you are in the want of honor through being wounded and betrayed and rejected, then you are vulnerable in your desperation to accept and receive the honor of a man. Because we want the quick fix. We want the quick fix. And if you can put it in a nutshell, if you want to differentiate between the honor that comes from men and the honor that comes from God, the honor that comes from God is something that you have to wait upon. It requires something called patience. Okay, so at that point, I think I'll read a scripture in Romans. I didn't even read the scripture I was going for in John yet, but we'll get back to that. Or maybe I will read it and then go to Romans. And because I'm winging it tonight, you'll have to suffer me flipping through the Bible. All right, search the scriptures. I'm going back to John and then we'll go to Romans, okay? You will not come to me that you might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you that you have not the love of God in you. I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive. So you see what he's saying? He's saying he's giving a criteria about how he knows whether the love of God's in you. He says, I know the love of God's not in you because a man will come in his own name and him you will receive. You will practice this bestowing and honor one to another, man to man. But I've come in my Father's name. See, my Father's name, a name not known by men. Right? Does the world know us? The world knew him not, so the world knows us not. They don't know you. Oh, Jonathan, sure they do. Why, that fella down at the motel that you fixed the toilets for, he knows you. He calls every day and says, is Jonathan there? So he knows you. No, he don't know me. He knows some guy who does plumbing that he can use for his advantage to maintain his cause and his hotel and his business. That's what he knows. He does not know Brother Jonathan, the Son of God. He knows me not. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? The world doesn't know you. They don't know that name. You come in your Father's name. Well, what denomination are you? You know, what name of a man? Luther. You know, you say some of the denominations aren't named after men, but they were started by the name of a man. You know, Wesleyan is a denomination known by the name of a man. Lutheran. Okay, so everybody is willing to bestow and say, oh, you're a Baptist. Okay, I receive. I have nothing against Baptists. Oh, you're a Pentecostal. I got nothing against Pentecostals or whatever. If any man would come in his own name, you would receive it because you can relate to men honoring men and back and forth. Because that's what the love of the world is. It's men recognizing the need in each other to be accepted and volunteering their own self-willed acceptance one to another to make themselves feel like they belong and like they have a sense of identity and fellowship and unity so they don't feel all alone and alienated. Because that's really what torment is. Torment is when you are in the state of death. And death is just simply separation. When I have no identification with you as a brother or a sister or as a companion, when I'm rejected, when my soul is alienated from all fellowship, that is torment for you to be alone like that. It's a torment for you to be separated like that. That's what hell is separation. Separation from God. You know, when you're in hell, you can cry and no one's going to be interested in your cry. Because they all got their own cry. Everybody's going to be in their own cry and in their own torment. All right, so he says, if any man come in his own name, him you will receive. But I'm come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another man come in his own name, him you will receive. So as soon as you say, I'm going to identify with none of these things that the world recognizes in terms of any kind of identity, I'm going to be talking primarily religious identity, denominational churches, the names of men's ministries, the names of denominations, but also identifying with a race or identifying with a political party or whatever your identification is. Everybody is looking to connect themselves with something. You know that, right? Because they want to be accepted by this organization. They want to be a part of it because they don't want to be alone. First thing God said about man in the garden. First thing, look, it's not good that the man is alone. Not good. And all us virgins and eunuchs here, we're not alone because we're married to the Lord. Okay? We're married to our brothers and sisters. We have a spiritual marriage that covers that issue. So I don't want you to look at that too literally to justify a pursuit of a physical marriage if God doesn't have it in the plans for you or for me. But you see, it's not good for the man to be alone. I'm speaking in respect of seeking honor. So then he drops this scripture on him. He says, how can you believe, you that seek honor, one of another? That's the world's exercise. That's their practice. Because the world is without God, and everybody has to have honor. Everybody. Everybody has to have some honor. Not to the point where you're worshipped above God or anything, but you have to have honor. You have to be identified with somebody else. You have to be accepted by something else. You have to belong, be a part of something. And the heart of every man fundamentally is driven in the pursuit of that honor.